Good afternoon. We're going to get started. I'm Charlie Robbins. I'm the Vice Provost for Undergraduate Education and Dean of the Undergraduate Colleges here at Stony Brook. And it really is my extreme pleasure to welcome you all to this afternoon's lecture. This lecture is part of the Provost Lecture Series, and we are co-sponsoring with the Center for the Study of Men and Masculinities. So I welcome you to the university, to the Wong Center. I want to call your attention to upcoming lectures that are part of the Provost Lecture Series. We have a series booked throughout the academic year that you'll find interesting and stimulating and really worth your while. So I would urge you to look online at the roster of lectures that and really illustrious people that we're bringing to campus over the course of the academic year. Today's lecture is by far one that I am most excited about bringing to campus. And I'm going to introduce somebody who's going to introduce our speaker. But when I heard from the Center for the Study of Men and Masculinities that it was possible to bring today's lecturer here, and the question was asked if we could make it part of the Provost Lecture Series, I literally didn't hesitate. I thought it was really exciting and a talk that should be given here and a message that we all should hear. So without delaying it any further, it is my pleasure to introduce Michael Kimmel, who is a professor in our sociology department and the director of the Center for the Study of Men and Masculinities. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Michael Kimmel, and it is my pleasure to get to introduce Jack Halberstam. I'm really thrilled about this. When Jack told me about the possibility of being at NYU for a semester, I said, "Well, we've got to get you here. We've got to get you to Stony Brook." So I'll give you the formal introduction first, and then I'll say something a bit more personal. So Jack Halberstam is professor of American Studies and Ethnicity, Gender Studies, and Comparative Literature at the University of Southern California. Author of 5 books, including Gothic Horror and the Technology of Monsters, Female Masculinity in a Queer Time and Place, The Queer Art of Failure, and most recently, Gaga Feminism, Sex, Gender, and the End of Normal. Articles appeared all over the place. Halberstam co-edited a number of anthologies and a special issue of Social Text a couple of years ago, which had the title "What's Queer About Queer Studies Now?" The project that Jack is working on now is one called a book called "The Wild," and I have a feeling we're going to hear something about that today on queer anarchy, performance, and protest culture, the visual representation of anarchy, and the intersections between animality, the human, and the environment. I hope we're going to hear about that today. So let me just say something personally. Did you ever have the experience where you read a book and you didn't like it, but you couldn't stop thinking about it? That was my experience the first time I read Female Masculinity. I did not like that book. I read it to screen it for a graduate seminar on masculinity, and I thought, oh, this is provocative, this is great. And there was something about it that just, I kept thinking about, like, how can we valorize female masculinity the way, and yet so vilify male femininities? The hairdressers, the fashionistas, the librarians, the academic dilettantes, the ladies' men. How come male femininities don't resonate? How come we never see a book like that? I got angry, but I couldn't stop thinking about it. It just got under my skin, and I just had to think about it, and I kept going back to passages that I remembered, and then I said, okay, Kimmel, just read the damn book again. And then I fell in love with it. Then I realized that what was happening in it, one was the fact that I remained in my own way of reading it so deeply embodied and so committed to the relationship between bodies and gender. And the book forces you to think about how that might be a problematic relationship. And it forced me to do that, in part by my immediate reaction to it. So then I was at least a fan, because the next time that I met Jack was when we were both keynote speakers at a conference in Costa Rica, and that's when I became a groupie, because I heard the talk that accompanied Gaga Feminism, and it completely rocked my world. So now I know that I'm able to introduce Jack to you, not only as someone who will get under your skin, force you to think about things that you don't particularly want to think about, and in ways that you don't particularly want to think about them, but will entertain you enormously while doing so. Jack Halberstam.
Thank you. That was a great introduction. And I honestly couldn't have written about masculinity without the work that Michael has done. So this is a real pleasure to be here. It's a pleasure and an honor to be part of the Provost Lecture Series and to be speaking to you at Stony Brook through the Center for the Research on Men and Masculinity. Now, I'm not going to talk extensively about men and masculinity, but in the second half of my talk, when I introduce you to a queer film that has really kind of gotten lost, it's been lost to history, and I want to reintroduce you to it, it has one of the great butch characters of all time in it. So we will work our way back around to female masculinity as we go. So what I want to do today, you can see that one of the undertitle, if you like, rather than the subtitle of my talk, is on the pedagogics of unlearning. And this is something that I've been trying to think a lot about, is not just how we learn, but how we unlearn kind of common sense and dominant opinion, and how we make space in our minds and in our being for different ways of knowing the world. So that's what I want to do today, is kind of be provocative. I think you can get from Michael's introduction that I excel in irritating people and bothering people with ideas that you're just like, meh, I don't know about that, but maybe you'll return to the idea later. So the short story is that I wrote a blog this summer about triggering that really, really bothered a lot of people. And I want to return to that blog in the first half of my talk to think about modes of representation, ways of doing what we do in the academy, ways of thinking, ways of disseminating knowledge, ways of teaching that we could do differently, that we should do differently, given that the world is changing, the university is changing. What we mean by knowledge and what its function might be is radically shifting and changing. So under these very, very unstable conditions, it behooves us to start thinking about who we are in the university and what we do. And that whole debate about triggering that still rages on in many ways, for me, flies in the face of the project. You know, the idea that people have to be warned about material in the classroom gets in the way of another kind of pedagogy, which is much more a sort of, shock and surprise, and the impact of the unexpected is what I seek to unpack for you. And this really comes to me, at any rate, through the work of someone like Jacques Rancière, and I'll talk about Rancière a little bit today, who wrote a book called The Ignorant Schoolmaster that basically claims that a lot of times professors, rather than teaching, they get in the way of teaching because it's so important to them to be the master in the classroom that it doesn't allow for the student ever to become their own teacher. That's where some of this idea of unlearning comes from, is this Rancièrean project within which the less teacherly that the teacher is, the more the student is actually able to enter into the material in a way that will produce this pedagogy of unlearning and create really startling results, okay? So that's kind of where we're gonna go. And we'll this is a little meme from the internet that, just to say that this idea of unlearning goes hand in hand with what I have called the queer art of failure. So I don't seek success within a normative model. I seek to fail in order to offer a critique of that normative model on behalf of a completely different epistemology. So on behalf of that completely different epistemology. Let me start with three propositions, and then I'll get into the two pieces of the talk. So first, and this is all, again, on behalf of this project of unlearning, helping us to think as a group about what it would mean to unlearn before we learn. So here's a question that you can keep in mind and that we can return to in the Q&A. Can we unlearn the political idioms and structures of knowing that currently keep us locked into our own private systems of pain and pleasure, but simultaneously prevent us from seeing the potential and even the rightness of other systems of sharing and co-experiencing? In other words, we make learning so individualistic and so much about the experience of each individual person and what they bring to the classroom that we renege on these other understandings of learning that are about co-experiencing, collaboration, learning with others, learning in relationship to others, being less of an individual in the classroom and more of a part of, a team, let's say, something like that, not to use too businessy of a metaphor. So can we unlearn these political idioms that keep us locked into these individual boxes and don't allow us to start thinking with others, which is part of what I understand to be behind the Rancierian project, that we not all just sort of invest in our own individual genius, but that we understand knowledge production as part of a shared labor, right? Something that there are many pieces to it that we all have to take a part of. Second, though, can we deploy different strategies of articulation? And you know, this is a good question for grad students, like what mode do you want to offer up your thoughts and your scholarship and your research in? We have only a very limited range in academia for sharing ideas, and that actually is a massive problem, and it isolates us from larger communities of thinkers and intellectuals because we remain locked into these idioms that are very proper to the university but don't have a lot of purchase outside of it. So could we deploy different strategies of articulation that would take us away from the explicative, and that's one of Rancière's terms that he really wants to reject, is the idea that the professor is always standing up explaining to people who know nothing, right? This mode of explication is great for a hierarchy, less good for a system of learning, okay? And away from the performance of diagnosis. The performance of diagnosis is where the professor stands up or the speaker stands up and tells you what's wrong. Okay, academics do that all very well, but what about the charge and the responsibility of saying what to do, right? For people who get to read and write and think for a living, we're short on what is to be done and long on what is the problem. So, but it's very easy to be cast as sort of disingenuous or naive or simplistic when you offer up provocative possibilities as opposed to complex modes of critique. So are there, in other words, not what is wrong and why, but what could be right and how? And this is a kind of, a strand of queer theory is invested in this kind of project that I would call utopian, or to use Jose Munoz's terms, anti-utopian thinking. It's not just utopian, but it's against the idea that the utopian has to be dismissed out of hand, okay? And then finally, if, as Rancière proposes in The Emancipated Spectator, the spectator must not expect to be enlightened by an aesthetic text, and the artist must not seek to teach the audience what he presumes they do not know, how can we stage the kinds of intellectual adventures, and I love that term, I love the idea that we are not here to just, you know, learn, master, train, but we're on an intellectual adventure. I mean, honestly, if you're not, you're in the wrong place, right? If you're not on an intellectual adventure, if it doesn't feel like an intellectual adventure, I don't really get why you're doing what you're doing. So how do we stage the conditions for intellectual adventures that surprise us, that are interesting, that we're invested in, and out of which we can then draw not simply conclusions, but we can see the glimmers of other ways of thinking, being, and interacting in the world. This would allow then for surprise, unanticipated outcomes and unpredictable effects. And that feels really important to me. I know in my own learning mode, if I am not surprised by something, I tend to ignore it. It just seems as if it's already something I know. So think carefully about how you learn and how you unlearn, and then, you know, see whether this idea of being on an intellectual adventure can work for you. And let's try one. You know, let's go on a couple of intellectual adventures. I hope they're intellectual. I know they're adventures. We'll see how that plays out today. Okay, and the path for this adventure is going to be a twisted path, not a direct line, not linear at all. But this is on behalf of a kind of Blakean project, which I feel echoes through someone like Rancière, definitely echoes through someone like Patti Smith, who we'll get to later. And Blake reminds us that improvement makes straight roads, but the crooked roads without improvement are roads of genius. So we don't want to go on the tried and true path. We don't simply want to be trained to find the right way to get somewhere. We don't simply want to be given maps when we enter into the university. We actually have to get lost and allow other people to get lost. And there you see the problem with the schoolmaster who insists on leading you by the nose and taking you to the trough and forcing you to drink. You know, these are not the ways to stage intellectual adventure. So we're going to be on a very twisted path, which means that it won't be just a clear argument all the way through. But I do promise you that some way or another, the two pieces of the talk kind of go together. All right, so let's start our little adventure. So this summer, you know, as academics are wont to do, I went to a conference. And it was, let me say from the outset, that it was a fantastic conference. It was a performance studies conference in a trans-hemispheric setting. The idea being that it was conducted in three different languages. There were people from about 10 countries. We watched performances, we watched theater, we watched plays, we watched, spontaneous performance art pieces. There were cabarets. It was fantastic. First 3 days, it was just like absorbing all of these different performances that I was seeing. Day four, however, things went really pear-shaped, to use an Englishism, when a really highly regarded queer intellectual from Mexico, Jesus Rodriguez, staged a play about a 17th century hermaphrodite, and this is an actual historical story, a 17th century hermaphrodite who was accused of raping another woman with her large clitoris, okay? And in order to be spared death by hanging, she had a surgeon excise her clitoris so that the state could not accuse her of having this, you know, rapacious organ, right? So that's what the play was about. It was set in a kind of comic vein, and it was followed by protests. And the protests came from both transgender participants in the conference and people who are interested in disability politics, who claimed that the play was staging a scene of medical intervention into the transgender body that was staged as humorous and allowed an entire audience to laugh at the gender ambiguous body. Okay, now, this kind of took a lot of people by surprise, and, you know, I just thought, well, that's interesting, that's an interesting read, and I thought it would go away. But before you know it, there were town hall meetings, long tables, and the whole rest of the conference was set up with this set of kind of sparking debates about every single performance thereafter, whether it was appropriate, whether it was, using the proper language, whether it was disrespectful, whether we should have agreed to put it on, whether we should have protested it, and the whole thing kind of collapsed. And I was super curious about this, and I wanted to make a statement about it connected to what I see as a kind of new politics of vulnerability that is focused not so much on vulnerable populations in an age of crisis, but upon the student in the classroom. And this, so that then you basically, students begin to think about themselves as sites of trauma, as vulnerable, and then see the material that's being taught in the classroom as potentially endangering them because it triggers for them flashbacks and memories that make them very uncomfortable. So I put this material together, wrote a blog, posted it, and it went viral. Okay. So it's super interesting when something goes viral. I'm sure you guys have, you know, all kinds of things have sparked massive debate on the internet. That had not been my experience. I had been posting on this blog for a long time, and I never had a blog go viral. And what happens when things go viral is awesome at first, because everyone's like, oh yeah, thanks for posting that. And you get a whole lot of nice feedback. But as it gets further and further afield, the feedback gets more and more vicious until it culminated in a student from Berkeley sending me death threats, okay? And so that was wacky, just wacky. So what I want to do is go back to the original post and elaborate some of the points that I made and then see if we can play them out a little bit in relationship to the second part of my talk. So I made five, and I, on behalf of this project that I set out at the very beginning of using different media to, you know, try to disseminate information or produce pliable environments for learning and so on, I like to use humor. So I had just been to see a Monty Python festival. I saw all kinds of Monty Python films back to back, The Holy Grail, The Life of Brian, and everything. And I'm watching The Life of Brian, and I'm realizing, I don't think you could stage The Life of Brian today. I really don't, given what had just happened at this conference. I thought, my gosh, what would happen if someone made a film about the Messiah, you know, about someone being mistaken for the Messiah named Brian, who ends up on a cross singing, "Always look on the bright side of life." It's kind of not thinkable anymore. It wasn't that thinkable when the film came out in the 70s, and in fact, it was, you know, as the Monty Python website says, it was banned in Norway, and this becomes, for Monty Python, this becomes an endorsement. Banned in Norway, you know, so now you know to go and see it. So I use Monty Python, and I will use Monty Python today, okay? So this section is going to end with a Monty Python clip that should lead us to a better way of thinking about the politics of harm and risk and safety and vulnerability and so on. Okay, so I made five arguments, and I'll just go through them one by one. The first question is whether these trigger warnings, which were introduced in Oberlin, I believe, a year or two ago, and then University of Santa Barbara, students, many of them under the influence of women and gender studies, by the way, began to ask for professors to use trigger warnings on their syllabi, saying that sometimes material would come up in the classroom that would trigger them and that they wanted warnings. So the first thing that I wanted to say and that I want to reiterate is that, you know, things, warnings presume that the material that's going to be presented in the classroom is sort of unidimensional in some way, and that you but class texts are not like films, okay? It's not like you can't just say warning, strong language, occasional nudity, sex scene, right? That's, what would that be like in a classroom? It would make nonsensical the project of walking into the classroom and having the text just be an alibi for certain thinking projects. So this whole idea about trigger warnings goes completely against what I'm trying to set up as the pedagogics of unlearning. If you already know everything that is to come, and you've already been, we've all decided in advance what might be potentially triggering, then it takes all of the element of surprise out of the classroom, but it also presumes a very unidimensional understanding of what it is to think and what it is to be in relationship to thinking in the first place. So that was the first thing that I wanted to say. Trigger warnings have lots of meaning online, where you're just flashing through sites, no meaning whatsoever in a classroom. But second, what is the relationship between trauma and material that triggers it anew? And this was something that, you know, I wasn't able to get into, and I really want to take up a little bit more fully here today. So in a trigger warning, the presumption is that the person, the student, or whoever it is who wants the warning, has experienced something bad. And then the presumption is that that's something bad, they will flash back on it if the same material is introduced, right? So there's a one-to-one kind of equivalence, i.e. if you have been subject to sexual abuse, the argument seems to be that any material about sexual abuse will trigger you. So what I wanted to say here was that the theories of trauma that circulate, in academia at least, are not about this idea that you're simply in relationship to the same material would trigger you, but that a trigger would be something that jogs the repressed material as it lies dormant in the unconscious. And it could be like a car alarm, something that was happening in the background when you experienced the trauma. It would be something banal and quotidian. It would not be the thing itself. So that already is an argument against the trigger warning. Do you see what I mean? Plus, lots of people experience trauma in relationship to the various oppressions of race, class, gender, sexuality, and disability that are not simply about sexual violence, and that are quotidian, are about exclusions, the unsaid, the unspoken, the being ignored as opposed to being focused upon. So all of those sort of absent places where somebody is basically being racially dismissed don't come up in that kind of material. So if we really want to learn from the way in which we've theorized trauma and the traumatized subject in academia, then the trigger warning makes absolutely no sense. And I just also want to give an example of this from one of my own classes. So a few years ago, I was teaching a class on the Holocaust, and I simply showed, day two, I showed Alain Resnais's brilliant film, Night and Fog, which is a challenging film, a spectacularly interesting film. It's one of the first film to use actual footage from the concentration camps. It's very challenging, it's about complicity, it's set in the moment of the French colonial aggression against Algeria. I mean, it's full of meaning. I show the film, and people start walking out. And so the next day in the class, I'm like, you know, what was going on? Oh, it was really hard to see that material. I couldn't sit through it after halfway through when we start to see bodies and so on. I couldn't sit through it. Okay. So I'm thinking, my God, well, what would that mean for students to ask for a warning about a class on the Holocaust? Do you know what I mean? You can't give a trigger warning for the Holocaust. Okay, because, and this is the point of teaching something like the Holocaust, is the way in which it defies certain forms of representation in its quest to be told, right? So this is, and then it came up again later in the semester when I showed them Triumph of the Will. I showed a piece of Triumph of the Will by Leni Riefenstahl. Now, the response to Triumph of the Will was the mirror opposite, and it was, could we see more? Okay, and they, of course, it's a seductive film. It is made to create a kind of charismatic set of images around fascism to reproduce the allure of fascism, and it actually introduces us to the way in which mass psychology actually works. But so that would be a text that one should actually warn students about and say, warning, you know, fascinating fascism ahead, right? Be aware that this text is literally constructed in a masterful way by, you know, this Nazi sympathizer, Leni Riefenstahl, precisely not simply to represent, but to seduce, right? And that's exactly what it did. So for me, it was very clear that Night and Fog must not be warned against and must simply be shown. And in that context, I would have warned against Triumph of the Will rather than simply show it. So there's just a very obvious but very kind of politically fraught example of how it is that people might respond to material and have responses to it for all kinds of different reasons. Similarly, you know, showing a film like 12 Years a Slave, people might say, oh, this was really hard for me to watch. One would want to uncover what made it hard to watch, you know, and all of the emphasis is going to be on how physically it was so hard to watch the punishment of the slave body. But, you know, there are many other reasons that, let's say, a white audience would find such a graphic film about slavery hard to watch that we actually should be investigating. So that's point two. Point three, is there a coloniality of the present? One of the problems with this atmosphere of believing that we should be told in advance, we should have our material pre-chewed for us, is that we assume that everything that we believe in, or the epistemologies that serve us in the present, can simply be applied to the past. Okay, so the coloniality of the present is taking material and frameworks and epistemologies that are proper to the world that we live in and then uncritically applying them to the past. So in the example that I gave you of the play by Jesus Rodriguez, the people who were protesting the play had decided that a play about a 17th century hermaphrodite was equivalent to a discussion of a transgender body. There has been, you know, 2 decades of work in queer studies about the fact that homosexuality is a very recent invention, transsexuality an even more recent invention, and therefore it would be very wrong, historically speaking, to collapse transgenderism from the present day into a case study of somebody who's ambiguously gendered in the 17th century, right? So there is no, what would be the rationale for a transgender person to be offended by material about a 17th century hermaphroditic body other than this colonizing view that presumes that any kind of moral system that works for us now can be applied to historically distant material. So that feels like a really important frame to respect difference across historical divides. Finally, second to last. Oh, so one of the, and this is important to the film that I'm going to talk about in the second half. One of the motivating factors for some of the debates about trigger warning had to do with also cleaning up the language that we use to talk about queer subjectivities. So on the one hand, students were asking that they get warnings in the classroom, and on the other hand, there was a desire to clean up the kinds of language that people were using to talk about LGBT people. So for example, in San Francisco over the summer, there was a big debate about whether the word tranny was appropriate. And tranny was the name of a long-standing club in San Francisco that has been around for about 20 years, that catered to transgender people and their partners. And that term, tranny, had been chosen by that community. But there was enormous pressure placed upon the club owner to change the name of the club. And she did. She changed it from Tranny Shack to Tea Shack, which sounds so weird to me, that a community of, you know, sexual minorities who have made it a practice to reclaim words like queer, like dyke, like fag, who have refused the culture of insult, and in fact have transformed insults into a kind of rebuttal of the politics of respectability, to tidy up the language in that way also feels really wrong. And in the film from 1979 that I'm going to show you, you'll see what happens in 1979 when these 2 runaway girls decide that they want to take that language as their own. So it's like a kind of the Caliban idea where Caliban in The Tempest says, you've taught me curse words, so I will use them to defile you. I will use them right back at you. This has been a very interesting and queer strategy for a very long time. So what does it mean when LGBT communities are cleaning up their own language? And is this part of the new politics of civility that we're all talking about on college campuses, this idea that we move away from these slang words and instead we enter into respectability by using the proper names? Something like that. All right, my final question is simply, my blog, when I wrote it, was supposed to be humorous, and so I ask, and this goes back to that one of those first points that I made, which is that academics have to find other mediums for conveying their ideas. And humor, as we know, is a very powerful vector for teaching. It's satire, irony, absurdity. These are all features of both high modern and very, very low cultural production. And it's really a shame to see humor as always suspect. And that was something that I really felt in some of these debates over the summer, was that humor was never heard as humor. Humor was always heard as offense. So why would we give up on some of these very, very powerful vectors of communication in the academy at a time when people in academia are perhaps less relevant than they've ever been to larger debates, okay? So every tool is important. So to that, I want to close this first half of my talk then with this funny moment from Monty Python's Life of Brian. And I don't know how many people here remember The Life of Brian, but okay, thank you, one person. I'm sure there are many more. Yeah. When I went to that Monty Python Fest, there were nerdy guys sitting behind me basically speaking along with the film. They knew every single line in it. It was really weird. But I don't know if you remember that the People's Front of Judea, you know, who are the rival group to the Judean Popular Front, have a meeting, you know, one of their many anti-imperialist meetings. And in the middle of this meeting, a claim is made on behalf of transgenderism being part of an anti-imperial project. So I just want to play you that little moment and then unpack it to finish up this section.
Only half a dinar, Tuscany fried bat.
I do feel, Reg, that any anti-imperialist group like ours must reflect such a divergence of interest within its power base.
Agreed. Francis? Yeah, I think Judith's point of view is very valid, Reg, provided the movement never forgets that it is the inalienable right of every man
or woman
to rid himself
or herself.
Agreed. Thank you, brother.
Or sister.
Where was I?
I think you finished.
Oh, right.
Furthermore, it is the birthright of every man
or woman.
Why don't you shut up about women, Stan? You're putting us off.
Women have a perfect right to play a part in our movement, Reg.
Why are you always on about women, Stan?
I want to be one.
What?
I want to be a woman. From now on, I want you all to call me Loretta.
What?
It's my right as a man.
Well, why do you want to be Loretta, Stan?
I want to have babies.
You want to have babies?
It's every man's right to have babies if he wants them.
But you can't have babies.
Don't you oppress me.
I'm not oppressing you, Stan. You haven't got a womb. Where's the fetus going to gestate? You're going to keep it in a box?
Here, I've got an idea. Suppose you agree that he can't actually have babies, not having a womb, which is nobody's fault, not even the Romans. But that he can have the right to have babies.
Good idea, Judith. We shall fight the oppressors for your right to have babies, brother. Sister, sorry.
What's the point?
What?
What's the point of fighting for his right to have babies when he can't have babies?
It is symbolic of our struggle against oppression.
Symbolic of his struggle against reality.
Okay, she just put the lights up. Okay, so I want to just unpack that last bit. Why is it symbolic of our struggle against oppression for them to stand up for Loretta's right to have babies that her body cannot produce? Okay, so I just want to think about this with you for a moment. This is a very typical Monty Python exchange, you know, where one python plays the role of interrupter. And I think the interruption is a super interesting motif, actually, and it works well with my idea that, you know, you have to interrupt learning and you have to cut off the speech that is about to produce common sense. And the interruption is, in fact, really, really important. So one python has to play the role of interrupter. The other has to play the role of pragmatist, and that's John Cleese, and he has to play it to absurdity. And then a kind of impossible proposal has to be made that they take to the very edges of possibility of absurdity and so on. So let's just play this through for a moment, and I'll just read this bit. So Loretta claims that it's her right as a man to have babies and that Reg is oppressing her by denying her this right. While the triggered response to this text might be to claim that it makes light of the experience of transgender women, the emancipated spectator's reading, to use Rancière's term, and he, you know, is always advising us to look at the entire visual economy of a scene rather than just look at what is said, the emancipated spectator's reading could open up the sequence to a new rendering of transgenderism as a desire for forms of embodiment that are necessarily impossible and deeply desired all at once. And this feels to me like the kind of intellectual adventure that I'm after, not where we make claims for bodies that we can now pragmatically produce, but that we actually make claims for bodies that potentially don't even exist, right? And that's one way out, let's say, of an identity politics. Just because Loretta's sex reassignment will never allow her to have babies, the People's Front of Judea affirms her right to fight for the right to have babies because this demand for the impossible symbolizes the anti-imperial struggle to which they have committed. So thus, the twisted path that represents the impossibility of transgender desires as a form that radical politics must take delivers us more nearly to utopia than a straight path that represents transgenderism as a right to perfect form. So transgenderism in this scene is not simply the right to be a woman and to be respected as a woman. It's the right to be in another kind of body that takes the form of womanhood but may not have many of its functions and therefore becomes a place of something else. Something that is not yet defined within this political framing, okay? So even though it's a silly scene, it actually contains within it more seeds, it seems to me, of a sort of political utopian thinking than a scene that very earnestly plays out a kind of rights-based claim on the state made by transgender people. Okay, so that's the end of that section, and now we move to section number two, defeated and gifted, which of course, 10 points for knowing that that came from Patti Smith's Pissing in the River, where she says, quoting Blake, should I pursue a path so twisted, should I crawl defeated and gifted? And the reason that I began with Patti Smith, apart from the fact that she is often channeling Blake, by the way, and is a kind of punk poet of the greatest order, is that her song Pissing in the River is the climax to this film that I want to talk to you about now for the second half of my talk. Unfortunately, because the film is very, very difficult to get a hold of, I don't have the scene where Pissing in the River plays, and it's a really, really beautiful scene, but I do have other scenes so that I can show you, give you a sense of the feel of this. So I'm going to talk to you, therefore, about a film that I believe holds within it the framework of a very different set of assumptions about the political, about feminism, about punk, about slang, about the insult, about teaching and learning, very different from the epistemologies that we are constructing and participating within today. And it's not at such a far remove, but it seems far enough that it almost is speaking to us from a very, very different world. The film is Times Square Alan Moyle. How many people have seen Times Square? Yeah, two people. Now, let me tell you, this is, for my money, one of the greatest lesbian films ever made. And it has played in all of my years of going to film festivals, which is going up on for like 35 years or something, I have seen this film twice. Once when it came out, 1980, I saw it the year after it came out, and once in 1986 in a film festival. Apart from that, it has not played. And there are many, many reasons for that. But let me give you the plot and then I'll take you through it. It's actually not a subculturally made film. It was produced by Robert Stigwood, who made Saturday Night Fever. And after the success of Saturday Night Fever, he wanted to stage another kind of film like Saturday Night Fever that was about a sort of subterranean world set in New York City, a world of music, peril, heartbreak, working class youth, and a film set against the backdrop of this ungentrified city. And you'll see in the film, there's already the threat of gentrification. The mayor that's being elected to office is running on a lifestyle platform in 1979. And some of the glimpses that we get of Times Square are so extraordinary. If anyone's read Samuel Delaney's Times Square Red, Times Square Blue, well, this is the Times Square he was talking about, okay? So when they call it Times Square, they're referring to this red light district, the district that we are, nobody's supposed to want to go, that is about to be cleaned up, but that, as Samuel Delaney says, holds within it subterranean worlds that are complicated, that operate according to entirely different ways of thinking, that are meaningful, that produce all kinds of different resonances of the political, the sexual, the erotic, the communitarian, the social, the racial, and so on. Okay, so that's the backdrop. But unlike Samuel Delaney's Times Square, where only one woman even appears in the whole book, this is a world populated by girls. Girls in relationship to strip cultures, girls in relationship to teen cultures, girls who are runaways, and girls who are being diagnosed, and this is the very beginning of a culture of diagnostics, who want to say to girls who rebel, it's not that you're angry, it's that you're sick, okay? And that's where we get, you know, back around to that sort of the trigger warning context. So before trigger warnings, what we had were these angry punk girls. So the film is set in Times Square. Trini Alvarado plays one of the greatest butchers in lesbian cinema, and you'll see this in a moment. She's in a mental hospital, and she's sharing a room with the daughter of the guy who's running for mayor of New York, Pammy. And Pammy's been putting there because she had an outburst at one of her father's press conferences because she's so angry with him that, therefore, there must be something wrong with her. The Trini Alvarado character says to her, is walking around with a boombox playing I Want to Be Sedated by the Ramones, and says to Pammy, let's get out of here. So that's the first 20 minutes of the film. They get out, and they go off, and they make a world for themselves in the night world of New York City. They scavenge, they produce a little home for themselves in one of the piers on Chelsea Piers. And again, the history of Chelsea Piers has been written as a history of gay men's cruising. But this film tells the story of runaway girls making their homes in the piers themselves. And then they form a band. And the band gets picked up by a kind of weird, lascivious radio host played by Tim Rice of Rocky Horror fame. And he starts playing their songs on the radio, and they develop a following. Okay, and they call themselves the Sleaze Sisters. So you can see this sort of attachment to the sleazy, the down, the dirty, the insult, the slang, the vernacular, and so on. So that's the point. Alan Moyle made this film. It's a fantastic film. It's well-produced, has very high production values. And then he dropped it. And he dropped it because the studios, back in 1979, would not allow him to release the film with lesbian sex scene intact in the film. And he was forced to take the lesbian sex scene out. As it turns out, you don't need a sex scene to get that the girls are in a relationship. But he was so pissed off by the censorship that he abandoned the film altogether and went on to make a film starring Christian Slater, radio something or other, and turned away from the girl heroines to the boy hero and did the same thing with the next film and abandoned this one completely. So this film languishes in the UCLA archives. So there's a 35 millimeter copy there. And there are probably scenes, you know, the scenes that were cut out are probably lying around there somewhere too. Let's hope James Franco doesn't get them, by the way, since... seems to be his thing to restore, you know, he's restoring the censored bits to cruising. So let's just hope James Franco doesn't decide to remake Times Square. But I want to give you a clip from the film, and I want to give you, to remind you of the idiom of cinema from the 1970s. It's less ferociously committed to telling a plot, telling a story. So you get long takes in, and if you watch Saturday Night Fever, you'll see the same thing. You get long takes that are basically fetishistic. They're scenes just of the image, the play of the image, where, yes, there's a certain kind of character that is established, but as in this scene, you're getting the feel of the relationship between the two girls rather than being told about that relationship. So I want to show you their interactions with people who are living on the streets in Times Square in this long kind of montage sequence.
Check it out. Come on. No sense makes sense. The Sleeve Sisters. Did you write this?
No.
Then somebody's taking our name.
Maybe somebody wants to be like us.
Yeah, it's like destiny, man. More Sleeve Sisters.
Okay, so we'll put the lights back up for a moment. Okay, so there's a lot happening in this clip. It's important that it's the talking heads in the background, and it, you know, you have this kind of funky soundtrack, but also that the interactions between Nicky and Pammy on the street are mostly with black people on the street, right? And there's a sort of, you know, within the idiom of the time, the idea is like the rebellion that they embody is also being connected to blackness, but also disidentified with it in that line, "Ain't no disco." The beginning of the film begins with Nicky making a ruckus in a disco and being like, "I'm a punk and I hate disco." So on the one hand, there's an identification with blackness as a site of struggle. On the other hand, a kind of disidentification with disco as a place of conformity. But it's very much like Saturday Night Fever in that it's using a black idiom for an idiom of rebellion. There's also that great moment where you flash on the, you know, the marquee, House of Psychotic Women, which is a joke in this film. It's not the thing that they take as their identity. It's the joke. It's the idea of this vulnerable, traumatized subject is what they want to get away from. And also maybe even claim, you know, and Pammy says, "Hey, Nicky, that's us. We're psychotic women. We're going to own this." Then there's that great kind of anarchist situationist phrase on the bus, "No sense makes sense," which is one of the things that Nicky says all the time. No sense makes sense. And then finally, Pamela Pearl is missing, and Nicky draws a mask on Pamela, which becomes one of the signifiers of the band, and the girls who show up at the end for the concert are all wearing these little masks. Now, masking, you know, has a long tradition as a kind of a way of politically masking individual subjectivities and producing a sense of unity across the group through anonymity. And, you know, we've seen that in the Occupy movement and so on. So it's a really, there are a lot of scenes like that that give you a lot of information without telling you, that use music, the soundtrack is phenomenal. And in fact, one of the reviews of the film, if I can find it, was by Janet Maslin, that said that the only interesting thing about the film was, in fact, the soundtrack. She said, "The action is so false, the characters so unsympathetic and uninteresting, that after a while, the music begins playing the only dominant role." And I think even from a four-minute clip, you can see that that can't possibly be true, that the characters are so uninteresting. So obviously, the film bothers a critic like Janet Maslin on another level. David Denby also excoriated the film, but Playboy gave it 2 bunnies and described it as a triumph of sleaze over substance, which reminds me that I always want to get my film reviews from Playboy and not from The New Yorker. All right, so there's A House of Psychotic Women, which was a real film and was not even a B film. It was like a C or D film. So they're making their common cause. Punk makes its cause with this sort of the rejected culture, the detritus that plays, you know, on the marquees of Times Square. It's important to remember this film came out right before Cruising. It was not protested by LGBT audiences the way that Cruising was, despite the fact that there are elements to it that easily could have been repudiated. But it also wasn't given much attention, quite honestly. It came out, it was declared a misstep, and it was promptly sort of lost. I think, however, the film actually fits in very well with a different kind of lesbian political history that goes back to a group like the Lesbian Avengers, which was an offshoot in the mid-80s of ACT UP. And remember, this film is made on the very cusp of the AIDS crisis, 1979. We have not yet had these headlines about a gay cancer. And that's important in the next scene. I'm just going to play, this scene for you. There's a moment in the scene that tell us that we are not in the era of HIV and that people are not worried about blood infection. In this scene, you see a sort of bonding between Nicky and Pammy that goes beyond just a sexual or an erotic relationship and is a commitment to a particular way of being, a way of life, a scavenging way of life, living on the very edge of the city and looking out across the Hudson becomes this sort of utopic moment in that Munozian way of looking at a horizon of potentiality. And this is Pier 56, if anyone goes to the piers now, like Chelsea Piers or something, it's unrecognizable.
Hey, back porch. Come on, Pam. Now I see. Why didn't I realize it before? God, now I see it. Don't you realize this is it? This is the place. I'll show you. Watch this. Bad blood. Now give me yours. Come on, don't worry. I ain't gonna hurt you. Just relax. See? That's all. Now, I want you to listen to me. You ever feel like freaking? You get panicky? Shaky? I want you to call my name. Just scream it. Scream it as loud as you can. You know, like this. Pammy! Pammy!
Nicky!
Louder.
Nicky!
Pammy!
Nicky!
Pammy!
Nicky!
Pammy!
Okay, so that's a really, it's a beautiful scene in the sense that, again, it alights upon a different understanding of political connection, one that is not about sharing, you know, an identification, recognizing each other in the terms of, you know, lesbian or partnership, but understanding the other as somebody upon whom you can call, with whom you share a bond that here is united through blood, that constitutes a different form of kinship, that is about the space that they've made for themselves in an abandoned site at the very edge of the city. And what we, you know, I guess what I'm arguing for is mining a film like this for these sedimented political histories that we have in many ways abandoned as we've moved towards a politics of respectability. So I want to close with a final scene that puts the nail in the coffin on this idea of respectability and gives us a punk song that inscribes a completely different relationship to identity than the one that I described in the first half of my talk, where you have people who are united in trauma, who are vulnerable, who understand representation through their vulnerabilities, and who want to huddle together and move towards a certain kind of state recognition and a politics of respectability. This song, this punk song, this punk cry, if you like, is the politics of making unity not simply out of identities, but out of a shared experience of dispossession.
Yes, Father dear. You want to make Times Square as cold as your icy eye? Why do you want to punish people who aren't like you? You know, at home I've heard you use these following words: spick, nigger, faggot, psycho. Well, I just want you to know your daughter is one. Sick, nigger, faggot, bum, your daughter is one.
Doctor's a myth, cold, fart, holy man. You don't know anything about what makes me sick. All you know about is sucking up to import people, right, fat hun?
John, you sent us out live?
How did I forget you, con artist? Who do you think you're kidding with that shit-eating smile of yours? You know what? Your bedside manner makes me whoop my cookie. Give me a puff.
Sick, nigger,
has come. Cause I'm a time bomb. I'm gonna explode all over you people.
Sick, nigga, faggot, bum. Your daughter is one.
Okay, I'm just gonna give you my conclusion now. And in this last scene then, Nicky and Pammy play a punk song at the radio station where a kind of creepy Tim Curry presides as King of New York. That's his radio moniker. In this scene, the girls cleave to and claim the words that their culture have used against them, and they make identity, as Hani and Moten might say in the undercommons, out of dispossession and brokenness. Just as they salvage furniture, dress in garbage bags, so they reclaim the rhetoric of the insult and make common cause with the insulted, the abandoned, the marginalized, and the criminal. Should I pursue a path so twisted? Should I crawl defeated and gifted? So sings poet Patti Smith in the film's climactic moment of rupture. Pissing in the River rejects the language of improvement and rejects the straight and narrow, preferring with Blake, one of her favorite poets, to take the path so twisted and the crooked road to genius. I propose that we think again about giving up on words like tranny, about losing the connections forged through dispossession and loss. These bonds, as Christina Hanhart's work in Safe Space shows, allowed queers in the 1970s to understand their political struggles as part and parcel of a more thoroughgoing critique of economic and racial policies. Once that understanding of social justice movements gave way to an anti-violence and pro-gentrification gay agenda in San Francisco's Castro District, in LA's West Hollywood, and New York City's Times Square, we lost the ability to imagine these different struggles as part of each other's fabric, as twisted or braided together through a shared sense of disaffection, abjection, refusal, and anger. Instead of trying to get this sense of a multi-directional politics back by creating checklists of political goals and identities, and by snapping our fingers and applauding when we hear the right words and phrases, we might want to return to the politics embedded in the curse or the insult and look to a horizon at the end of a path so twisted where we find not heroes and survivors, but the defeated and the gifted. Thank you. So I believe we have time for some questions. And there are microphones, so you don't have to scream. Yeah.